So we part. This is part two of our series, I Want to Believe, But. So if you remember last time I preached, we spoke about on-demand God that says, you know what, if I pray, if I push the right buttons, then God will do exactly as I want. And we explained to you that on-demand God doesn't exist. All right. Next time I'm going to preach is going to be a good one. A lot of people fall prey to this one is who we call goosebump God. This is the one that says, if I don't feel him, I don't believe in him. Right. And like, how are you supposed to serve a God? How are you supposed to pray to a God that you can't feel or you can't experience him? So we're going to talk about goosebump God. And then the last one in the series, which is probably going to be like the one that makes a lot of people not want to be Christian, or even the one that turns a lot of people away from Christianity, which is heartless God. How can I serve a God that allows stuff like tsunamis and hunger in Africa? How can I serve a God who allows death and decay and calamity in this world? In fact, how can I serve a God that allows these things to happen in my life? All right, so we're gonna cover that topic in the last time. So keep watch over your SMSs when we go on with the series, that you don't miss anything. I'm not gonna like dig into the first one again. So if you missed it, go check on our YouTube channel and watch it, and then you'll be up to speed with where we're at. Today we're gonna talk about killjoy God. All right, I wanna believe God, but there's just too many rules and regulations and do's and don'ts to this Christianity, and I've had some experience growing up as a pastor's child, man. You get to know this part of Christians that you don't want to know, all right? You see people being hypocrites. You see people, you know, dressed suits and ties. They've got the look. They've got everything. But you see behind closed doors what happens. And it's, man, like, oh, I just don't want to be like them. They're narrow-minded. They're hypocritical. They're judgmental. They're boring. They're rigid. Some of them are nerdy. How can I serve a God that wants me to be like that? You know, we want to have fun. We want to go to friends' places, enjoy parties, kiss girlfriends and boyfriends, and just make out like we want to. We just want to have a blast on this earth, you know? So how can we serve a God that wants to limit us, that wants to limit the fun that we have? And many people view Christians as such, that they are the killjoy people. God is the killjoy God. And I want to tell you that people are not rejecting the true God, because like we said in the beginning, people are rejecting a distorted view of who God is. Because when it comes to killjoy God, people aren't rejecting Christ. They're rejecting the Christ that Christians present to them. Remember, we are called Christian, which means like Christ, mini version of Jesus Christ. That's exactly what the name Christian means. And because Christians represent Christ wrong, people get a distorted view of God, and they don't want to follow God. Come on, even Gandhi himself said it. I like your Christ, but I don't like your Christians. He said, I would follow your Christ if it weren't for your Christians. How intense is that? And we do so much damage in the kingdom of God when we get it wrong and when we display God wrongly. And that's why we need to learn, and that's why I feel so strongly to do this series, because we need to learn the correct view of God, who God truly is, so that we can represent him well. See, so today I'm gonna share some good news and I'm gonna share some bad news about Jesus and religion. Now, when I speak about religion, I'm not talking about Christianity, because it's not a religion. And I know it's cliche.
It's not a religion, it's a relationship.
I'm not here to talk cliche. When I say religion, I'm talking about the man-made rules that's in place to try and please God from a physical perspective, from a physical aspect. That is what religion is. So I'm going to talk to you about, quickly, the bad news of religion, and then we'll talk about the good news of Jesus. The bad news about religion is that one thing you've got to understand is religion will always focus on the external rather than the internal. Come on, it's easy to go like, man, look at those people, they're hypocrites. It focuses on the outside, what's going on the outside. And yes, don't get me wrong, I'm not going to preach that sin is okay and you can have a blast and sin away. That's not what I'm saying today. So don't get me wrong today. There is external stuff that takes place. When you follow God, there are some outside changes, because the Bible says you will know them by their fruit. Okay, so people will see, but it's not about the outside. It starts with the inside. And that's why Jesus had a big problem with the Pharisees, because they were all about the outside. You know, they were all about the suits and ties and bells and whistles, and they wore the right clothing, prayed the right prayers, but their hearts were far from God. And Jesus made this statement in Matthew 23, verse 25 to 26. It says, "Woe to you, teachers of the law and Pharisees, you hypocrites! You clean the outside of the cup and dish, but inside they are full of greed and self-indulgence. Blind Pharisee, first clean the inside of the cup and dish, and then the outside also will be clean." So Jesus is talking to them, and he's saying to them, there's another portion in the same version of Matthew where he says, "You are whitewashed tombs. Like, you're white and you're pearly and you're beautiful on the outside, but inside you stink like a rotten corpse." And that's why Jesus says, get your heart right. Get the inside right. Because the thing that religion does is there's this gap. We can't deny it. There's a gap between us and between God. And that gap was created by sin. That is why sin is such a big issue. And that is why we'll tell you the truth about sin. We'll not water it down because sin is an issue. It's a problem. But the problem in fixing sin is not drawing away from sin. It's drawing closer to God. That's how you fix the problem. But the thing is, many people think we can draw closer to God, we can close the gap by what we can do, by human effort. And this is exactly what the Pharisees did, what the teachers of the law did, is they had all these lists of do's and don'ts, trying to get the approval of God, trying to get the acceptance of God through what they did physically. So it's all the human effort. And the Pharisees, you can go and read about them. They were like the guys who prayed the long prayers. You know, long-winded prayers. Daai gebed wat amper nooit ophou nie. Dan dink jy, yes, like it, dude. Wanneer gaan jy? Stop. Okay. Like, they kept on going. And then on top of that, they would rip off widows. And they would do a lot of things. And they had all these rules. Don't work on the Sabbath. Don't eat the wrong foods. Don't hang with sinners. You see, and it's this kind of religion that is all about the do's and the don'ts, the rules and the regulations. And once we understand the history, why it's like that, we kind of understand why they got to that place. The heart of God was understood in the beginning, but because it was starting to be misrepresented, it got twisted along the way. Now, my Bible school people, second years, would know this because we did it this Thursday. We spoke about Ezra and Nehemiah, all right? Now, these two leaders, they were religious leaders back in the Old Testament. And the one thing about the Old Testament, when you read it, there's this sad, sick cycle that Israel goes through where they are close to God, then they are on the mountaintop, then they start sinning, then they find idols, and then they fall down and they get punished and they get taken off into captivity. Then a prophet comes, warns them, you better turn against the wrong stuff. You better turn towards God and repent and get back to God. And then they get back to God and then they find false idols again, and then they worship false gods, and then they fall again. So it's this sick cycle that continues to go. And Ezra and Nehemiah were really close to the Lord, and they saw the land, the people of Israel, after what God has done, after all he saved them from, they saw them turning their backs on God again. And it really frustrated them, and it got them to a point where they got really angry. Because not because they were angry at the people, but they were angry at the fact that, man, if you sin against God and you keep doing this, you bring yourself into bondage and you live under a curse, and we don't want you to live under that curse. So with the right intent and the right motives, they wrote extra laws. Now remember, God gave the law, which was the Ten Commandments. He gave it to Moses, and we find the law of Moses, all right? Now, the law of Moses is called the Torah, which is the first five books of the Bible. That's the law of Moses. So that is the law given by God. That is God's heart. If you want to know what the law of God is, read the first five books of the Bible, and you'll understand what is God's heart towards man and what he wants man to do. So then what Ezra and Nehemiah did is they wrote 600 different man-made laws to protect the law of Moses. So it was what we call fence laws to protect the Torah. And just in these 600 laws, there were 65 do's and don'ts just about Sabbath keeping. That's crazy. Like what you're about to do and not to do on the Sabbath. 65 different rules and regulations. So these man-made laws were later compiled into a book in the 3rd century called the Mishnah, which was about 800 pages long. 800 pages of laws of do's and don'ts. Yikes. And the thing is, the Pharisees knew this off by heart. They were religious scholars, very devout, and they knew all these things off by heart, and they lived it to the letter, all right? If the Sabbath said, man, I'm not allowed to flip a light switch because it counts as work, they didn't flip a light switch. They stayed in the dark. If the Sabbath said, don't eat because eating is work, they would not eat on the Sabbath. They really followed it to the letter, but they misunderstood the heart of God in the original law of God. And that's why another place, Jesus says, Matthew 23, verse 3 to 4, it says, don't follow the example of the Pharisees, for they don't practice what they teach. They crush people with unbearable religious demands and never lift a finger to ease the burden. You see, and this is killjoy God. And what I want to tell you today is killjoy God does not exist. He's not the God that we serve. You see, God's laws, the law of Moses established by God, the Ten Commandments, those laws were never put in place to burden us. They were put in place not to confine us. They were established by God to put us into a place where we can live life to the full. Why? Because if we live in the boundary lines established by God, we live life in His blessing and we reap His abundance. If we overstep the boundary lines, we live outside of His blessing and we reap what comes from it. And therefore, we need to understand the law of God was never intended to confine but to free. And that's God's true heart. When there's something in the Bible that says, I want you to do this, it's never to put you into a box. It's to keep you into a place where you can live in God's fullness, where you can enjoy life to His extent, not our extent. You see, so let's look about, that's the law. Let's look about the good news of Jesus. Now, there's this scripture in Romans 3, verse 20 to 22, it says, therefore, no one will be declared righteous in God's sight by the works of the law. Rather, through the law, we became conscious of our sin. But now, apart from the law, the righteousness of God has been made known, to which the law and the prophets testify. This righteousness is given through faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe. Now, this is my first point that I want to make is you cannot earn God's acceptance by obeying the law. There is nothing you can do in your physical capacity, nothing you can bring that'll be okay to God enough so that He will go, you're good enough. The Bible says in Isaiah that our righteousness are like filthy menstrual rags before the Lord. Ugh. But that's what the Bible says. The best of the best of the best of your works that you can bring to the table physically to try and earn God's redemption, to try and earn God's acceptance, to try and earn God's love and His grace is like filthy rags before God. It's beneath His notice. And that's exactly, religion says you can please God by your works. Do good, don't do bad. Go to church, be a good person, be baptized this way, be dunked once and in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Read your Bible this way, pray this way. Then, you know, you have this list of don'ts. Don't drink, don't smoke, don't run with girls who do, don't chew. You know, don't do all these things. Just live in your box. That's religion. And once again, I'm not saying there are no rules. I'm saying we've got to understand how to follow them. You see, Romans 3 verse 20 says, therefore, no one will be declared righteous in God's sight by the works of the law. No one. No one will be declared righteous. There is no law that you can do that'll make you righteous. Paul, in another passage, actually says, if you want to obey one of those 600 and something laws, then you are guilty of all of them if you break one. How intense is that? Why did Paul say that? Because the law was never meant to be followed to the letter. There's a heart behind the law that was established. This is what brings us to the next point. The purpose of the law is to show your need of a Savior. The purpose of the law is to show you your need of a Savior. And that's where the second part of that verse comes in. Romans 3:20 says, through the law, we became conscious of our sin. You see, the law is there to point out to us that we cannot be good enough. Now, I know we live in modern times and in modern days, and man, the easiest way for a pastor to to get people upset is to tell them they're sinning. In fact, the easiest way for anyone to get someone upset is to tell them, listen, you've got sin in your life. You can't judge me. I've preached about that also. You can judge, all right? You're allowed to point out people's mistakes to them if you don't have the same mistake in your life. So if someone comes to you in love and say, you've got a sin in your life, and they really mean it from a loving perspective, don't jump to defense mode and go, you can't judge me. Hypocrite. Rather receive it in the spirit. But the biggest thing today is we are quick to go like, I'm not a bad person. I'm not wrong. Don't call me a sinner. Who are you to call me a sinner? We family, but I know she's someone net daar en ek som by hierdie familie wees want hulle aanvaar my soos wat ek is. As jy rondhardloop met mense wat jou heeltyd net aanvaar vir hoe jy is, kry ander vriende because they're going to lead you to destruction. You need people in your life that can challenge you and that can call you out on the wrongdoings in your life. But now you say, no, I'm not a bad person. You know? Yes, maybe you're not a bad person compared to someone else. Maybe you're okay compared to the next guy. But compared to God's standards, we all suck. We all fall way short to do what is right. Now, if you still don't believe me, let's do a quick test. Raise your hand if you've ever told a lie in your life. Okay, now quickly look at the people not raising their hands, point at them and say, liar, liar, pants on fire. Huh? Because if you've never told a lie, there's something not right with you because you have lied somewhere in your 85 years of living. All right? Now, let's look at another one. Who's ever stolen something? Now, let me quickly define stealing. If you are on Facebook during work hours and you have work to do, that counts as stealing because you're stealing time from your boss. All right? So even that counts as stealing. So who's ever stolen? Right? Daar's mense wat hulle hande nie opsteek nie, maar jy het van die kerk se penne gevat en jy teken jou 10de checks met daai. Ja? Moenie worry nie, hulle is daarom verniet. Okay, so many of us raised our hand on that one. So here's another one. Ek wil niemand in die moeilikheid kry nie. So vir diegene as jy skuldig is, maak dit so. All right? Who's ever lusted? Okay? Daar's party en sê ja. Okay. Maar nou nie vrouens, moet nou nie kwaad wees vir jou man nie. Dit kan like way back BC days wees. So dit mag dalk nie vandag wees nie. As dit vandag is, slap hom later. So all of you raised your hand to most of this, okay? So according to this, we are all good church-going believing people, right? But according to what we've just established, we are all lying, thieving adulterers. That sounds like pretty bad sinners to me. You know, we are wretched people. We are horrid. We are disgusting. Welcome to Bikers Church. We make you feel good about yourself. We are really bad people. According to God's standards, we cannot make it. And until you realize that you are a sinner and that there is stuff in your life that needs to be saved from, until you realize how bad you truly are, you will never realize your need for a Savior. So until you see yourself as a sinner, you won't see your need for a Savior. And that is why it's important for the law to be there. That's why it's important to be convicted of your sin, so that you know, man, I'm in the wrong. I need someone to save me. I'm stuck in the sin. I can't get out. I need a Savior. Are you a bad person? Yes, we all are. Because we're all sinners, inherently. Can we be good? Yes, we can. Through the blood of Jesus and faith in Him, He can make us good. And that brings me to my last point. See, the first one says you cannot earn God's acceptance by obeying the law. Second one, the purpose of the law is to show you your need for a Savior. The third one, the good news, is being right with God comes by faith in Christ alone. Romans 3:22 says, the righteousness is given through faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe. Through faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe. You see, you don't get right with God by what you bring to the table. You get right with God once you realize that, man, I am a bad person. I am not as good as I should be. I need a Savior. And you lift your hands and you cry out to God and you say, God, save me. In that faith that you place in Jesus, in that moment, God comes into your life and He makes you a new person. And you don't obey the laws of God and live right because you need to. You obey it because of the grace that has been deposited into your life. And all of a sudden, I want to live right. Why? Because there's been a change inside of me that has to show on the outside. That's what true grace does. See, grace is not just freedom from sin. Grace is empowering you to live a sinless life. And that's why I'm here to tell you today, you don't need religion. You don't need religion. You need Jesus Christ. You need more of Him in your life. You need more of Him. You need to build your relationship with Him, because the closer you are to Him, the closer you are to the light, the further away you'll be from the darkness. The closer you draw to Jesus, the more right you will live. The closer you live to Jesus, the more pure and holy you will be. It's not about stopping your addiction. It's about getting close to God. Why? Because if I'm close to God, I don't want to be in that nonsense. I don't want to cuss and swear. I don't want to be found amongst the people that do. I want to be different. I want to be a change. Why? Because something is different inside of me. You see, it brings me to the criminal on the cross. I don't know, all of you should know the story. Jesus hung in the middle, two on the side. One cussed and sweared, and like, if you're the king, who they say they are, why don't you just get yourself off the cross and save us too? And I can guarantee you that person is not in a good place today. But there was one sinner on the other side that said, Jesus, would you just remember me when you're in paradise? Just remember me. He didn't say, God, save me. He didn't reach out, but God saw his heart and God saw the earnesty in his cry saying, remember me. And Jesus told him, today, you will be with me in paradise. No, that's not possible. He needs to get off the cross. He needs to get baptized first. He needs to fix his wrongdoings, because he is a sinner, man. He's not on the cross for no reason. The worst of the worst of the worst gets on the cross. So he needs to come down there and fix his life first. No. He's not made righteous by fixing his life. He's made righteous by the blood of Jesus. And because he's made righteous and because he's made new, he has access to the kingdom of God. You see, religion says what I do. Christianity says what Jesus has already done. Religion makes it all about me. I need to do this. I need to do that. I need to stop this. I need to pray more. But Christianity is all about Jesus. It's what can I do to get closer to my Jesus? Religion says do. Christianity says it's done. The price has been paid. Religion says, if I obey, then God. No. Christianity says, because he loves me, I don't have to obey, but I get the privilege to obey because he loves me. Because Jesus said, if you love me, you will obey my commands. So I get to obey his commands. Why? Because I love him that much and because I realize what I've been saved from. See, most people are not rejecting Christ. They're rejecting the wrongly represented Christ. And I want to urge us to start representing him well. It's not rules, 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 and religion. It's simple. You see, religion has complicated what God has made simple. From the very beginning, you see God's heart is a simple heart towards us, that he wants to love us and he wants us to love him back. Come on, think about Adam and Eve. God made Adam, and a few days later, he thought, man, just like it, okay, so he made Eve. So they were both naked, which is pretty awesome. Naked in paradise. So they were in paradise, and God said, have fun, fill the earth, subdue it, enjoy paradise. Name the animals. Do all of this. Everything. You can eat of every tree you want to. Just don't eat of one. The tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Because if you do, you'll surely die. But have fun. Come on, you go and name a giraffe and a donkey and a lion. You've got a lot to do. Go and name them all. Go and enjoy life. Be fruitful. Multiply. Fill the earth. Have communion with me. Have relationship with me. Just one thing. Don't do one thing. And why did God say, don't do that one thing? To limit them? To keep them in bondage? No. God said, don't do that one thing from that which would steal your life. God said, just that one thing that'll steal your life. Don't do it. But enjoy. You see, and unfortunately, they did that one thing that stole their life. And that brought them under the curse. And that's exactly God's heart. He makes things simple. See, Psalm 16, verse 6, David says, the boundary lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. Which means, man, I can live on this side of the boundary. My boundary lines are in pleasant places. I can live life to the full and have God's blessing. And I don't need to overstep my boundaries. Why? Because that side is nonsense. That side is horrible. That side brings me under the curse of God. So the boundary lines have fallen in pleasant places. And I am happy to live on this side of the boundary because I live in the fullness of Christ. And that's where we want to be. That's where we need to be. He says, good news. We sin. Jesus died and God forgave us. We can't earn it. We don't deserve it. God has given it to us freely. It's not about being perfect. It's about Jesus and being with Him. And as much as we are connected to Him, we live free from sin. Why? Because He makes all things new. He says, it's not complicated. It's about love. Come on, just think about marriage. Those of you who are married, you laid down the law the day you got married because you promised to love one another until the day that you die, to be faithful to one another. How boring is that? No, you need to be faithful to one person. No. How wonderful is that? Because it's a boundary line. And staying in the boundaries of marriage, sex is wonderful. Making love is wonderful. Raising kids is wonderful. Outside of that boundary, it destroys, it kills, it breaks lives. But inside of the boundary, there is love and life to the fullness, because in that relationship of marriage, you will enjoy the fullness of life being faithful to your partner that you promised it. The boundary lines fall in pleasant places. You see, there was a religious leader that asked God, what is the most important commandment? Do I need to do this? Do I need to do that? Do I need to do the other? And Jesus said, no. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your mind, all your soul, and all your strength. And love your neighbor as you love yourself. Come on, if I love that much, how can I sin against God? If I love that much my neighbor, how can I hurt them? How can I do things towards them? And your neighbor isn't just the guy next to you. It's everyone you come into contact with is counted as a neighbor. Black, white, Hispanic, Chinese, Italian, everyone. Love your neighbor as you love yourself. You see, religion complicates with laws, and Jesus simplifies with love. See, I don't have to obey, I choose to obey. My last example is the woman caught in adultery. And if you haven't read the story, the Pharisees threw a woman at Jesus' feet. They said, she's caught in adultery, 5 different men. The law says we have to stone her. What do you say? Jesus dropped down into the dirt and he started writing. Now, we don't exactly know what he writes, but some scholars believe, they take an educated guess and they say they think he started writing the sins of the people who were accusing the woman, because as he was busy writing, people started walking away, and it started from the oldest to the youngest. And his words to them was, you who are without sin, throw the first stone. And when he got up, all of them were gone, and he asked the woman, where's your accusers? And she said, I don't know, they're gone. And he said, if they don't condemn you, neither do I. But then his words was, go and sin no more. See, we never hear about this woman again. We never hear anything afterwards. But I can guarantee you this. She never broke that law of adultery again. Why? Because there was a law, because she was afraid of being caught again? No, she never broke that law again because she was forgiven and she was loved. Never in her life did she overstep that boundary again. Why? Because the boundary line fell in a pleasant place. Forgiveness and love brought her to her King, and it changes. You see, when you are forgiven, when you are loved, when you encounter the forgiveness and the love of God, you can't other than give everything. Your only reasonable and natural response is to give everything to the one who gave everything to you. We cannot do anything else but give our lives to God. So let's just close our eyes for a little while. I just want you to think about everything you've heard. Maybe you've had an image, and the wrong image of Jesus because of what some churches and what some people showed you. But God is not a killjoy God. He doesn't want to box you in. He wants you to live life in His abundance. He wants to love you and He wants to forgive you today. But you need to realize your need for a Savior. So if you just want to come to Him, maybe it's the first time that you give your life to Him. Maybe it's the second or the third time you just want to fix your life. Maybe it's the 100th time and you've found yourself way off the road and you just want to come back to Jesus. Don't you just want to raise your hand so I can pray with you? I'm not going to ask you to stand. I'm not going to ask you to do anything weird. I just want to pray with you. So just be bold and say, Jesus, I need a Savior. Jesus, I need saving in my life. I need forgiveness. I don't need more rules. I just need your love. And that love will change you once you realize how much He loves you. Is there anyone else? God, you see every hand raised in this place. God, and I pray that you would come into our hearts, come into our lives. If it's the first time, or if we're coming to just make right with you, we want to declare that we believe in you, Jesus. We believe that you died and that you rose again. And we cry out and say, Jesus, we need you. We need a Savior. We realize we are bad people and we are in need of something good, of someone better. We need you, Jesus. So I pray that you will break away every bit of religion in our hearts and our minds, where we've been blinded, where we've been sidetracked, where we've been keeping ourselves busy with a list of do's and don'ts, and we haven't been keeping ourselves busy with you. God, I pray that you'll bring us back to your heart, to your love. God, I pray that right now, every hand that is raised, and even those that are too afraid to raise it, God, that your love will break through in every single heart and life in this place, that your forgiveness will be tangible, that they will be able to feel it and experience it as it comes into their hearts, as it comes into their lives, as it brings freedom and revelation of your love and your grace. And may that change them and make them all a new creation. Come and create in us clean hearts, oh God, clean hearts, and bring us to a place where we are renewed and restored in the blood of Jesus. And help us to rise today, children of God, changed and renewed by your grace and ready to live lives. Help us to do right, to obey, not because of the laws, not because of the lists of do's and don'ts, but help us to do right and obey because we love you that much, God. And we thank you for that, Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit, that you just come and seal this in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen.